So I guess we'll get going. So we'll keep within the time frame to finish, you know, for the beverages later. So it has been suggested that a resilient gut microbiota is a stand-in or a surrogate to a healthy microbiota. Science has shown this, you know, the importance of this time and again, and sorry, I forgot my glasses. I need this. I'm getting old, man. Science has shown the importance of this time and again and how it ties into health and wellness. The last presentation of our panel will feature work that was initiated a few years back, put on hold, and I think it's finding life again, right? So please help me in welcoming Sylvie Binda, the newly appointed Vice President of Research and Science at Lalma Health Solutions.
Hello everyone. So as said by George, I'm the new Vice President of R&D in Lalma Health Solutions. But today I will speak to all of you to the name of IPA Europe. And I have the pleasure to be considered not as the chairman, but as the chairwoman of the scientific committee. What is really important, just before to go directly to the subject, is why we have a scientific working group within the IPA. I will say that probiotics is also linked to the science, and we know that we have always using a lot of, you know, graph showing the number of the publications, but I think it's really important to think that we need science. And what it's really, I would say, really important, it's we have this collective thinking, because we are not only just people from IPA, we are also people coming from different industries. And it's really important to say that this is a collective thinking for a strategic and collective intelligence. What is also important to mention is that it's all about science, but science, what is really important, it's to communicate with the others. And here you have just a mention of things what we are discussing during the last 2 days, it's the definitions. So in July 2020, we published a paper called The Criteria to Qualify Microorganisms. The idea on that paper was to say how we can build an easy ways to say that this is a probiotic or this is not a probiotic. And the paper is not just coming from IPA, it's a paper built with some members from ISAP, the other organization you know on probiotics, International Scientific Association of Probiotics, as for example Marie-Hélène, but also people from university as Professor Colin Hill. And that paper was really important because it's quite a pragmatic way to be able to say this is or this is not. So the paper is a peer review, was published in Frontier of Microbiology last year and is open access. So you can go on that one and take it. The second thing is just an illustration also of science, how we can make a scientific dialogue with other scientists. So the last example is we organized a webinar in July in where we were talk about healthy aging with two key scientists in the field, so Professor Brigidi and Claudio Franceschi. And what was really important is that this webinar was built as a kind of scientific dialogue between two key scientists in the field. And it's still also available on the webinar, on the YouTube, on our YouTube IPA. So resilience. Why we decide to make something on resilience? Because you know everybody now is talking about resilience. But in 2016, when we decided to work on that project, the idea was to be able to answer to, I would say, the series of three questions. The first one was, do we think today that there is a science, a scientific consensus behind microbiota? There is a consensus behind microbiota and stability, instability, or there is also a consensus for probiotics acting on microbiota. And the idea was really to build the scientific rationales to be able to make a kind of deposition. So the initial idea was clearly, I would say, the piece of convictions toward the authorities and especially the European one. So we want to identify where was the science and where was the consensus to act on that, to build it, and to be able to potentially submit to the authorities. Maybe to go just before to the resilience, I think we have to know that resilience is not just a fashion word as today. is coming from the ecology and is coming at the beginning in 1958. In where the first one to use it was Professor Elton in 1958. And at that time was really an ecological concept. And it was more about, you know, the notion of the stability and the question of the perturbation of an ecosystem. There was not the mention of the dynamic, so it was more the question of the stability. In 1973, the one which is really considered as the father of the resilience, which name is Professor Olling, published this really famous book called The Foundation of Ecological Resilience, in where he was really able to describe what is an ecosystem and what does it mean between the communication with members. And for him, it was really the resilience is really depending on the way that people interact and also how interact, for example, the community members. And he defined what he calls the ecosystem level factors. So that one was really at the beginning in 1973, not a concept for a microbiome, was a concept for ecology. In 2004, still with Olling, there was a definition, the one which is still used today, was really resilience was defined as the capacity of a system really to absorb the disturbance, meaning that, for example, if you have a perturbation, you can change a little bit. For example, you have this fluctuation, and you will come back again to the initial status, in where you have to also to keep the same function at the beginning. Okay. So it was in 2004. You know, in parallel, there was all this explosion of the science on the microbiome, and a lot of people, and especially coming from Stanford, decide to think about how we can use the concept of resilience, an ecological concept, to another ecosystem called the microbiome. So the first, I would say, the first conversation of transfer from ecology, I would say environmental ecology to human ecology was in 2007, first one. And it was really defending already this aspect of how something coming from ecology can be applied to the something which is the living things inside you. And I would say the keystone papers was the one published in 2011. So the PNAS papers, in where they published for the first time a real demonstration, in the sense of human demonstration, in where you can see what he calls the perturbation regime. And this PNAS paper was done with a famous experience in where he took three people during 1 year, and they tried to make a perturbation, antibiotics perturbation, and in where they tried to follow the impact of the ecosystem, meaning the impact of the microbiome. I will not enter into the detail on the part of the perturbation because I will explain later. But what was really important to understand is that in 2011 and 12, they were the first one to prove that you can transfer an ecological concept to the human microbiome, and clearly demonstrate the fact that it can be applicable to have this ecological view on this microbiome. For sure, he put also a cautious to say that we have at that time, in 2012, a limited understanding of the ecosystem services to the people. Okay, so if he said that living ecosystem is something inside us, we can use this analogy that, okay, for a baby is a small ecosystem because we know that during the first, I would say, the first 3 years of life, you have not a lot of, for example, microbes, so you have probably 1, 2, 3 species, 4, 5, and more. And for an adult, in where you can consider that there is a stable microbiome, you have like a forest inside you, okay? We know that babies and adults is not the same, at least for the question of the microbiome. Resilience and perturbations, you can just make the illustration that a resilience, the capacity of this loss, you can have this forest, which is at the end clearly not a good, I will say, stable ecosystem, and it's really fragile, really fragilize you, and this is just an illustration on that. I think it's really important to just see the correlation on something which is an ecological point of view to something which is also an ecological point of view inside you. What was also important is that in 2016, there was still in that spirit the notion of what they call the stable state and the life trajectory. meaning that all the question is really a question of moving from different status. For example, from a development point of view at the beginning of life, when you are considered as, I would say, as a kind of stable ecosystem, but also where you are, for example, also considered as an unstable, you know, ecosystem. For example, we know that there was a lot of demonstrations that a microbiota in babies perturbed by a lot of antibiotics, you have, I would say, an increased factor of the increase of the dermatitis atopis in the children. So I think it's really important to see that, I would say, this perturbation resilience as a kind of change every time of something which is stable, resistant. You can have also a dysbiotic, and after the key question is how you can go after to something considered as a disease state, can you able to go back to something considered as healthy? So we were in 2016, so I think it's really important just to replace where was the science at that time. And at that time, already in 2016, people were really convinced that there are a lot of factors which are influencing the gut microbiota. Exercise, nutrition, genetic stress, the time of the pregnancy, the type of birth also, and the age, the healthy aging, and the antibiotics. Today, we will focus on two things, the dietary challenges and also the antibiotics. And as presented by Bruno, we know that there is quite a lot of associations between the quality of diet, diversity of the diet, and also a lot of changes according to the composition, for example, in the microbiome. 2016. In 2014, one of the, I will say at that time, one of the good publications was a publication published in the BGN from Power, in where they try to see and to prove the associations between the human microbiota with a lot of intervention with diet challenges. What they saw is that, at least in three clinicals, there was clearly a link between a challenge of diet with the compositions of the, you see, of the microbiota. For example, if you use during 1 month a gluten-free diet, you can see a real decrease of the composition, and especially the decrease of Bifidobacterium, Lactobacillus, but also, for example, Fecalibacterium prodicis. So maybe, Philippe, you was already there to discuss in that one. So the question is, we were in 2014, that one is still true. So the question what we show is that a perturbation today for microbiota with last scientific advances, even in 2019 with, I will say, new type of tools, we are still able to see that there is clearly a correlation between the dietary diversity also with the microbiome stability, which is really important to say that the whole findings that we use as a kind of builders of our strategy in 2016 are still true 4 or 5 years after. That one, as I said at the beginning, was really the one really important as a kind of, I would say, the key reason why for the transfer of the resilience, the ecology concept to the microbiome. That was this famous experience of Defflesen and Hellman, in where they used during 1 year, 3 people, probably Defflesen was one of the one, he was a student at that time, and he used 5 days of stress, so it's the red arrow. The first one, you can see that you have, just after the perturbation induced by the antibiotic, you can see on the composition index a kind of changes, okay, just after. And it's particularly true in the subject C, in where you can see the big differences between the initial status just before the stress induced by the antibiotic, and just after you can see the changes. After, they, you know, they wait for 6 months, mean that you have just 5 days of antibiotics. You wait 6 months without antibiotics, with a classical diet, and you can see that, and especially for the subject C, he never go again to the initial status. What they did, a second challenge with the same antibiotics, 5 days, and you can see something really important is that not only the first antibiotic treatment really lead to a temporary microbiota diversity loss, meaning there is a changes, but also there is clearly, and it's really remarkable in the subjective, there is clearly the loss of the capacity of the microbiome to get back to the initial status. So meaning that it's just 1 year, it's just two courses of antibiotics in 1 year. Can you imagine the impact of antibiotics during your life? So this was in 2011. This was just only 3 subjects. The question is that still true? So one of the most recent publications on that, with a human intervention, is the one published by Merenstein and team in 2021, in where they follow people, healthy subjects, with a challenge with antibiotics, 14 days, with amoxicillin and clavulanate. And they use as a kind of intervention, a yogurt made with BB12. And what they show, two things. The first one, you can see at the left side of my slide, you saw that this is the level of short-chain fatty acid, so acetate, propionate, and butyrate. You can see, so at the time zero, there is the concomitance between antibiotic first day and you take the first yogurt. Okay? What you can see is as soon as after 5 days, you can see that people who are eating the yogurt, there is a small resistance, but they really decrease the level of the production of short-chain fatty acid. But clearly, the one without the yogurt, which in probiotics, there is clearly a significant decrease during this antibiotic courses, 14 days, but also after, because after 15 days after the end of the antibiotic, they're still not come back again to the initial status. So this is true for, I would say, the metabolism of the microbiome, but this is true also on the composition of the microbiome, because you can see also the blue one, the change on the composition of the microbiome, there is a kind also resistance, so there is a change, but after 14 days at the end of the antibiotic, you can see that you come back to the initial status, meaning that you have this resilience. But for the others, after 30 days, you are still not coming back to the initial status. Meaning that the intervention and the perturbation induced by antibiotic is still true, that you have clearly an effect, a profound effect on the microbiome. So in 2016, there was a kind of maturation of the science, and that was really important. There was more consensus on the fact that it's easier to consider and to qualify a non-balanced microbiota, but not really the normal microbiota. So at that time, we were considering that this notion of the trajectory and the notion of ecological movement, you can see that if you go, for example, after a perturbation towards something which is not really stable, you can have a pathobiont expansion. You can have also the clearly reduction of your diversity, and also you can lose your beneficial microbes. And at that time, that was considered that the perturbation induced by antibiotic and diet and stress also was the reversible perturbations, meaning that you can have still this resilience, but probably there are also a lot of irreversible perturbations like the immune system failure, but also the type of the bird delivery. So it was in 2016. So at that time, so the idea was to say, okay, we build the science, we read all the publication, and we have to design to a clinical demonstration because we have to use science. And we decide to a model of the clinical demonstrations, and as we were in the spirit of resilience, and we were considering that our time sequence of events and also our model of demonstration was using probiotics, using a perturbation induced by antibiotic, and be able to follow the time sequence of event, meaning before the challenge, after the challenge, and the time of the recovery. So the idea was to follow what we call the initial status, or can be also a new stable state. At that time, we were lucky also because there was a publication of a systematic review published, I would say, in 2014, in where there was this work done by Lynn McFarland, in where she tried to compile all the science, clinical science, on the usage of probiotics to correct dysbiosis. So at that time she was called, you know, the normal microbiota, following diseases or disruptive events. So what we, from this systematic review, we decide to include also several clinical investigations, and we focus on several things. The first one, for sure, we were with antibiotic challenge model, with general populations, because we were in the food, with adults mainly. Why we want to focus on adults, it's because we still consider that during the childhood, at least till 3-4 years, the microbiome is not really stable, so it's really easy to follow, it's not really easy to follow the resilience. And the idea was also to be able to evaluate different probiotics, different doses, and also to have the inclusion of different parameters which are able to follow, I would say, the time sequence of events and the changes within the microbiome. So what we did is we did this summary of the state of the art. So it was clearly a selection of publication from a clinical trials coming from 1991 to 2016. So at the end, we decided to retain just 21 studies with 19 strains coming from 6 taxa, B. animalis, lactis, bifidum, lactoacidophilus, casei, paracasei, rhamnosus, and one yeast, the Saccharomyces boulardii. So it was, as I said at the beginning, we need to have antibiotic treatment, we need to have intervention from probiotics. We are in the adult, we have to have a microbiota assessment, and we have clearly a demonstration, we have to have a demonstration of the resilience. So we did that, and it was clearly on the spirit of a deposition on the dossier. So the idea was also to build, if we want to deposit this, what does it mean? In the sense of what does it mean from a regulatory science point of view, but what does it mean also from a health science point of view? So we said that this microbiota resilience is really this ability of a microbiome to recover after a challenge. And in our model, we selected the antibiotic challenge. And we know that from science point of view, we know that from a short-term point of view, there is clearly a risk of pathogen growth and the GI infections when you have this reduction of the capacity of the resilience capacity from the microbiome. You have for sure the development and the possibility to develop a risk of diarrhea associated to antibiotics. But for a long-term period, as mentioned by Rellman with a lot of investigations, we know that the recurrent perturbation in this trajectory of life lead clearly to a decrease of the resilience capacity of the microbiota with a shift in the microbiota composition, which can lead to the risk of development of IBD, obesity, diabetes, all the things you learn since the last 10 years in all the congresses. So the claim that we want to propose at that time was, for example, help recovery of individual microbiota after a challenge, help for better recovery of individual microbiota under after challenge, and the last one, contribute to maintaining individual intestinal microbiota in subjects receiving antibiotic treatment. That one was really, I think, selected in the spirit of EFSA. Why? Because we also analyze all the negative dossier from EFSA, because at that time it was also just negative dossier. And in that one, in two dossiers, they mentioned that the fact that if you are able to show that the contributions to maintaining individual intestinal microbiota in subjects receiving antibiotic treatment might be a beneficial effect. It's for this reason we said, maybe we can try. We try also a lot of things, because if we build science, we have also to make it known. So we try also to work with people like people from ISAP, because they are also convinced by the microbiome resilience. And for example, with some people from ISAP, we describe in two scientific blogs What is the resilience? What does it mean? What is important for health? And etc. And it was published in 2018. So in 2019, what do we have? We have a 70 pages of a scientific monography covering old and recent findings. For a lot of reasons, scientific probably, but also a lot of political decision, we said that we don't want to submit the dossier. So we were a little bit, I would say, frustrated. And that dossier, I think, is in maybe in the PC of one or two people in an IPA. So we said, Okay. I don't know if we were young, but at least we were right. Why we say that? Because microbiota resilience is still a topic which is than ever attractive within the scientific community. So we were in 2016 in were less than 100 publications, 4 years after more than 250. Maybe it's just a number, I know, but at least the topic is also interesting in the, I will say, in the scientific community. What is really important, I can mention that also in 2016, because that table was already true in 2016. The overview of existing claims all over the world, you can see that all the claims dealing with the question of probiotics use microbiota ecological concept. For example, in Canada, probiotics that naturally form part of the gut flora. Probiotic live microorganisms that contribute to the healthy gut flora. In South Korea, help to maintain healthy gastrointestinal bacteria population, support the balance of the intestinal flora in Italy. So you have plenty of examples in where clearly they use the dimension of the ecological view of this ecosystem that we have inside us. In Europe, not defined health claim. And in all the negative dossiers, we have always this point, not defined health claim, intestinal microbiota, balanced microbiota, beneficials, increasing number of bifido, blah, 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 blah. So we were in 16, EFSA has also a possibility of what's called the public consultation. So in 2016 and 17, that was a public consultation in where with some members of IPA, we published a lot of comments. And one of the comments, we said, maybe use, microbiota resilience can be really important. And we mentioned the Gudderson definition that we use also in our dossier. And what was really important is that in August 2017, when EFSA published again and make an update on the guidance document on biological relevance of data in scientific assessments, they put the definition. And they said that reducing homeostatic capacity might be detrimental, whereas increasing the capacity could be beneficial. So that was already something really important to mention. And in June 2020, clearly, as mentioned also by Bruno just before, but also this morning, clearly there is a willingness now to include microbiome point of view, microbiome ecological point of view inside the evaluation of all the questions related to health claim, which is, I will say, really, really positive and really important for us. And you can see, and especially on the right side of the slide, extreme and sustainable and sustained adverse exposure can lead to profound ecological disruption and a breakdown in the host microbe partnership, contributing to adverse health outcome, which is clearly the links of this resilience of the microbiota. I think there is still a question, how to define and calculate a resilience index, because do you think that just the notion of, I would say, the speed of the recovery of the initial status can be just sufficient to show that there is a beneficial effect? There was a publication in where there was also Professor Doré, so it was published in 2020, in where they propose that to define and calculate a resilience index, it's clearly a quantitative measure on how much the microbiota can derive from a baseline and how quickly and fully it has recovered. What is really important is to mention that which is really simple, and it's really important also to show that it integrates every individual complexity in that index. So the question is, are we there yet today? What is really also really important to mention, so even in 2020 and 2021, you have a lot of initiatives still in on resilience. So the one at the upper part is the one coming from Stanford Medicine. So they put what they call a citizen collective project, in where the idea is that for people who are really volunteers to work on resilience, to evaluate their resilience, can go to Stanford, and during 1 year, they will be followed, and they will have a lot of, you know, microbiota investigations. They will have also some food questionnaire, and they will, I will say, they will learn if they have a capacity of resilience, but they will learn also how to take care on that resilience, which is really important. There is also a lot of, I would say, European initiatives. So one of the last one is the one called Microbiome Support, in where clearly they put all the ecological concepts in the ways to put forward, to move forward on the microbiome investigation. And especially they talk about resistance, resilience, and homeostasis. The last one is the one proposed yesterday by Professor Brigidi. And you can see also in Italy, they really also propose what they call the One Health approach, in where clearly there is the notion of ecology and microbiome, all the biome, not only human, but also the one coming from human, from animal, and also from the environment. For sure, we are scientists, but there is still some needs and challenges. We need probably to have more controlling trials for most common microbiome stressor. We need really to understand what is a stressor, what is not a stressor. We have also to think about the dietary strategy for maintenance and also the restoration of that function, and especially the resilience. What is really important to understand, we know that there is this trajectory all during the life, in where you will have stable and unstable states. But the fact that what does it shape, this stability and this instability and your capacity, for the moment, is still not really well known. We have a lot of associations, but clearly the key levers, if I just took the word of Professor Rowling, for the moment, they are not really well known. And there is also the mention and the question of how, what is today the appropriate scale to follow, I would say, this ecological approach to the description of the microbiome. So before to close the session, our take-home messages for today, it's a take-home messages, but also a call for actions. So the study of the microbiome, I would say stability, is really key to understand the relations with health maintenance. Probiotic probably could play a positive role to support microbiome resilience. We need really to redesign nutritional intervention. We need to demonstrate this impact of diet, maybe with live microbes. And we propose also to go on this elucidation on the mechanism of, I would say, the resilience of the microbiome, and we need to help us to contribute a consensus. So maybe before just to say thanks, I want just to say that I was really lucky because I have a team. So my team was the team with David Obis from Danone, Arthur from IFF, and Bruno Pott from Yakult. I don't know if we were a dream team, but at least we were all together. And if it's still unclear, this is a demonstration of what is a resilience. Thank you.